Good morning. Welcome, everybody. Good job being on time to church. Impressive. But good to be together. My name is Dave. I'm one of the pastors here, and I want to just connect on a couple things as we start today. First of all, I want to welcome anybody who might be visiting. Maybe it's your first time, or maybe you've been here a few times. We absolutely love that, and we love getting to connect personally. So if you have a moment after church, come hang out. We've got a little welcome area. We'd love to say hi this morning if you're a guest. For everybody, every time, we have a thing called the Connect Card. It's digital. It's through our app that you can find. It's called Church Center. Here's why that matters. Because we're a church family. We want to know what's happening for you. It's helpful to know that you come. It's helpful to be able to pray for you. So if you don't have that app, please get it. And then each time you come, it'd be great if you check in and just let us know that you're here and let us know if we can be praying for you in the coming week. We, as a church, we want to be growing in prayer. Personal prayer, prayer as a church family, and so we're trying to create some opportunities for that. This week is an opportunity to grow in prayer, okay? We're encouraging kind of a day of prayer starting Wednesday evening. If you're able to fast and pray, we would encourage you to start Wednesday night after dinner and then pray through Thursday. And then on Thursday evening, we're going to create an opportunity here where we're going to have a chance to break that fast, to have a meal together. We'll have some food trucks out in the parking lot at 5:30. At 7 o'clock in this room, we'll have a prayer and worship night. Now, we're not just inviting our campus. We're inviting all six of our campuses together for that. And so we need to and we want to seek the Lord in prayer. So I'd encourage you to consider that day, setting that aside, and then that evening, that's this Thursday, the 8th. In fact, it'd be okay even right now if you want to get your phone and put it on your calendar. I will not be offended, okay? But we're going to come together 7 p.m. this Thursday night for a night of prayer. Let's start our time together by praying. Why don't we stand? Why don't we all stand? And let's just take a moment to prepare our heart for the worship that we want to give to our God this morning, all right? Heavenly Father, in this first few hours of a first day of this new week, we praise your name. We thank you for your faithfulness, Lord. I've heard testimonies this morning of how you are healing, how you are strengthening, how you are providing. And I also know many stories where people are trusting you and burdened and struggling. And Lord, where does our help come from? Our help comes from you, maker of heaven and earth. And so we want to lean in and give you our full attention, our devotion, and our praise because you are worthy. Lord, would you lead us and receive our worship this morning? We pray all these things in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen. All right, let's pray. Let's give the Lord the praise.
this out together, church. Christ is my firm foundation, and the rock on which I stand. When everything around me is shaking, I've never been more glad that I put my faith in Jesus. He's never let me down. He's faithful through generations. So why would he fail?
Come on, as a church, we declare.
He won't. I still got joy in chaos. I've got peace that makes no sense, so I won't be going under. I might fail by my own strength, 'cause I built my life on Jesus. And he's never let me down. He's faithful.
Save it.
Truth in that song, that no matter what the circumstances may be, we get to stand on a firm foundation through Jesus today. And as we go into a time of open mic scripture, I'd like to invite you to take out your Bibles. And I love in the author of Hebrews teaches us that during trials, we can either lean on him or we can lean on ourselves. And when difficulties arise, we might be tempted to revert to our own ways, our own sinful, old sinful patterns. But I love that scripture instructs us to cast off what hinders us and to joyfully look to Christ as our example. I don't know about you, but it's a good reminder that to know that he's working actively right now in our lives for our good and his glory. And he assures us that when we fix our eyes on him, the author and perfecter of our faith, we can live lives of faith with the joy of heaven. Hebrews 12 says, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with perseverance the race that is marked out for us, fixing our eyes on Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. For the joy set before him, he endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Consider him who endured such opposition from sinners so that you will not grow weary and lose heart. And we're gonna respond by singing a song. And as we worship, God might be highlighting a Bible verse or two in your heart right now that you've stood on during times of trials or perseverance. And if that's you, I'd like to invite you to come up to the front. We got leaders on each side. And after this song, we're going to have a time to not only encourage the church, but to strengthen the church with his word. So I'm going to pray, and then we're going to sing, and we're going to respond. So Jesus, we thank you for your word. Thank you that it's living and active, sharper than a double-edged sword. Thank you that it pierces through the hardest of hearts. And in this moment, we fix our eyes on you, the author and perfecter of our faith. Come have your way in this place. We need you. We want you. In Jesus' name. Glorious song.
Psalm 27, 1 through 3. The Lord is my light and my salvation, so why should I be afraid? The Lord is my fortress, protecting me from danger, so why should I tremble? When evil people come to devour me, when my enemies and foes attack me, they will stumble and fall. Though a mighty army surrounds me, my heart will not be afraid.
That's right.
Even if I am attacked, I will remain confident.
Amen. Amen.
Psalm 18, 2 through 3. The Lord is my rock and my fortress and my deliverer, my God, my rock in whom I take refuge, my shield and the thorn of my salvation, my stronghold. I call upon the Lord who is worthy to be praised, and I am saved from my enemies.
Psalm 91, 1 through 2. Whoever dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say of the Lord, He is my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust.
That's right. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Psalm 94, 18 and 19. When I thought my foot slips, your steadfast love, O Lord, held me up. When the cares of my heart are many, your consolations cheer my soul.
Romans 5, 3 and 5, say it with me, church. Not only that, but we rejoice in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us.
Psalm 103, 10 through 13. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love toward those who fear him. As far as the east is from the west, so far does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him.
Revelation 21:3. And I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, Behold, the tabernacle of God is among men, and he shall dwell among them, and they shall be his people, and God himself shall be among them.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Psalm 27, verses 1, 13, and 14. The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord. Be strong and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord.
Proverbs 3, 5, and 6. Trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Do not lean on your own understanding. In all of your ways acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths.
Amen.
Isaiah 41, 10. Fear not, for I am with you. Be not dismayed, for I am your God. It's powerful today, right, church? Do you feel his presence in here? I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand.
That's right. That's right. Amen.
Amen. Isaiah 54, 17. No weapon formed against you shall prosper. And every tongue which rises against you in judgment, you shall condemn. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and their righteousness is from me, says the Lord. Hallelujah.
One final breath and it was finished. Can we sing that one more time together? All hail King Jesus. Come on, lift your hands in this place in honor of the King of Kings.
Y'all are fervent and focused in your worship today, and I think that's fantastic. We want that in the reading of God's word. We want that in the songs we sing. We want that in the way we give of our lives, our time, our energy, our gifts, our resources. And so in this moment, we want to take just the opportunity to reflect on our offering to the Lord. And we do a general offering every week that meets the needs of the church, that allows the ministries to do all that we do and more. And then once a month, we do a special offering. And so this is the first weekend of August. We're doing a special offering just this weekend. This special offering is for two purposes, for benevolence ministry and compassion ministry. Now, benevolence, just think, that's our church family. We got to take care of each other, right? And so when tough times come, benevolence is a ministry that can be helpful to each other as a church family. And then compassion, think local area. Who can we reach? Who can we help in the name of Jesus Christ? It's like our hope centers and things like that. So just today, the special offering, that's what that's for. So you can always give the general fund. The special offering, there will be ushers at the door as you leave. All the different ways are available to give. But why are we doing that? Let's be reminded of what Jesus said. Then the righteous will answer him saying, Lord, when did we see you hungry and feed you or thirsty and give you a drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome you, or naked and clothe you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and visit you? And the king will answer them, truly I say to you, as you did it to one of the least of these my brothers, you did it to me. And so the reason is that our God is a God of compassion, and his son Jesus told us that in caring for others, we're reflecting his heart and doing what he would call us to do. And so that's between you and the Lord. By the way, if you're visiting, I'm not really directing this to you. But for our church family, we've got the opportunity to be a part of this together. And so consider what the Lord would have you do. We'll do that joyfully as unto him. And let's all pray together and commit this offering to the Lord. Heavenly Father, the fact that we belong to you is everything to us. To think that you have set your grace upon us and that you have lavished us with your grace is overwhelming. And Lord, we just truly want our lives to be pleasing to you. We want to read your word. We want to sing your songs. We want to do the things that you tell us to do. And part of that, Lord, is being faithful and being generous. And so, Lord, grow us in this. Let it be connected to our heart, certainly not under compulsion. Lord, would you use this special offering to remind some people who are hurting that they are seen, that they are known, that you love them, and that Jesus Christ is their hope. Lord, thank you that we get to be a part of this, and we commit it all to you. We pray all these things together in Jesus' name. Everybody said, amen, amen. All right, well, why don't you take a moment? We're going to get into the word in just a second in Malachi, but why don't you take a second and greet somebody around you. Say, hey, I'm glad you came today.
Hey, Harvest, so great to be with you in church this weekend. Grateful for our opportunity to get into God's word. I hope you're enjoying your summer. I hope you're enjoying this series. We've called it Thus Saith the Lord. And you know, the goal of all of it is really for us to hear from the Lord. As we walk through the different prophets that we're looking at each week, we're hopeful that we will gain the Lord's word and that we will gain a greater trust for the Lord. And some of you, I know some of you are more trusting than others. That comes easier for some people than others. Some are skeptical and others are very, very trusting. And to help everybody, we've actually taken the outline for the sermon this weekend and we've written it on the ceiling of every worship center in our church. And some of you are very upset because you fell for that. You're the people who, you know, believe me when I tell you that gullible is not written in any dictionary. Some of you are like, nah, I didn't fall for nothing. You're not pulling one over on me. But whether you're a trusting person by nature or someone who's a little more skeptical, obviously I'm being a little silly right now, and I'm sorry if you fell for that. But whether you're in either of those camps, our goal really as we turn to God's word is to trust his words. And we would say, you know, thus saith the Lord. And it's not enough for us just to recognize that God said these things to us. It's actually a goal for us to put these things into practice, to say, Lord, I trust you with what you've said, whether I understand it or not, whether I see it in my life right now, whether it makes sense with what I see right in front of me or not. I'm going to trust your word and I'm going to obey no matter what. It's my goal that we'll get there together as we look into God's word. Let's take a moment and pray before we turn to God's word. Father, we are grateful for this opportunity that we have to gather. We don't want to overlook that or neglect that. So we would pray that you would have us to lean into all that you would have for us from your word. Thank you for an opportunity to be together in each of these houses of worship, for the fact that we're able to lift high the name of Jesus Christ and to worship you in a greater way here together. And so, Lord, would you be honored even now through our time in your word? Would you stir our hearts to trust you more, to love you more, to obey and to follow you with all the days of our lives? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, today we're going to be looking at the book of Malachi, Malachi 3 specifically. It is the last book of the Old Testament, so it's really easy to find some of these minor prophets. Can we just be honest? You're like, I'm not quite sure where Obadiah is. It's fine. Malachi is a little easier for us. Just go to Matthew, take a left, you'll find it. Malachi is the last book of the Old Testament. Malachi literally means, his name means my messenger. As so much so that some scholars have actually said, I don't even know that it's a proper name. Maybe it's just a title. Maybe we're just calling the person who wrote it a messenger. After lots of study, I actually believe that it is his name, and it also serves as a bit of a wordplay for us. Like Peter, meaning rock, his name, Malachi, means my messenger. Even in chapter 3, verse 1, it says, behold, I send my messenger, and he will prepare the way before me. But I love that we're not actually sure who Malachi was. We don't have a lot of background on him, and I kind of like that. It's honestly exactly like the message today. It really doesn't matter who the dude is up here saying it. It really matters what God says, what we see in his word, what the message to us is. It's not about the person who's proclaiming, thus saith the Lord. It's about the Lord that's saith-ing it. That's a word. And so we're going to look at what God says to us. I told you I'm a bit silly. It's fine. We're going to look at what God says to us, his message to his people, a little context on what's happening around the time of Malachi. He's proclaiming God's word to the people of Israel as they're back into the land after exile. So if you remember, they go into exile because of their disobedience, and they come back to Jerusalem. We have books like Ezra and Nehemiah that are the beginning of the people coming back to the land, the promised land. And they came back. Malachi was written about 100 years after they had been back. And they had this idea that when we get back to the land, everything's going to be great. When we return to the land, we'll have prosperity and we'll have triumph and everything will be perfect for us. And instead, when they come back to the land, they found toil and hardship and injustice and poverty. It wasn't at all what they had expected. You see, they went into captivity because of their disobedience to God and their idolatry, away from their homeland for decades, and now they've returned to the land that had been promised to them centuries beforehand. But unfortunately, their change of scenery didn't change their hearts being far from God. They had believed if we could just get back to our home, then everything would be great, and then we'll follow the Lord. Then everything will be great, but that wasn't the case. They got back to the land, and they continued those same practices of straying from the Lord and idolatry and much disobedience. And before we are too hard on the people for not learning their lesson, we often do that very same thing. We often think, if I could just blank, then everything would be better. If I could just get through school, this is so hard. If I could just land this job, if I could just advance in my career, if I could just pay off this debt that I have, if I could just find a spouse, if I could just get to the place where I'm not so busy, then I'll follow the Lord. If I could just blank, then I'll serve the Lord. Then I'll obey him. When I kind of get my act together, then I'll do what God's calling me to do. The time to obey and to live for God is right now. It's not when something else happens. It's not because of a change of scenery that needs to happen in your life or in mine or in theirs. It's not after something happens. It is right now. And that's what the whole book of Malachi is about. It's these periods where God is bringing up these disputes to the people and calling them back to himself. It's a wake-up call to the people of Israel. It's a call to trust him when they see it and when they don't, to trust the Lord and to obey him no matter what. Now, this section of Malachi, Malachi 3, that we're specifically going to be looking at, it specifically talks about tithes and offerings and the way that they saw those things. God told the people to bring in their tithes and their offerings, but the people began to feel stressed about how they would be able to financially provide for themselves, and they stopped giving. They stopped doing the thing that God had called them to do. They thought, if we could just get our act together and if our crops would do better, if we could just make some more money, then we'll do the thing that God has called us to do. But the issue here in Malachi 3, it isn't the money. It's never just the money. Jesus said, where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You see, the issue with the people in Malachi's day is where their hearts were. The issue was that they were looking to their resources as their sense of security. The issue was they weren't trusting the Lord and what he had said to him. You see, it's not enough, again, to say, thus saith the Lord, and to understand what God has said to us. It's required that his word directs how you and I live and how we act and how we think. And that's the call to trust and obey that we see in the book of Malachi. The message for them, it's really not different than it is for us. It's a call to repentance. It's a call to trust. And we'll see in Malachi 3, three things. It's a call to trust in God's patience, in God's provision, and in God's power. Let's first look at the text. Beginning Malachi 3, beginning in verse 6, God's patience. He says to them, thus saith the Lord, for I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore you, O children of Jacob, are not consumed. From the days of your father you have turned aside from my statutes and have not kept them. Return to me, and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. But you say, how shall we return? Will man rob God? Yet you are robbing me. But you say, how have we robbed you? In your tithes and contributions, you are cursed with a curse, for you are robbing me, the whole nation of you. You see, the Lord begins here by calling the people back to following him, to trust him through all of it. The people are in a season once again where they're wandering far from God, and despite all of the provision that he has made for them throughout the past, all of the countless stories through Israel's past, and now bringing them back into the promised land, they still disobey and they're still sinful in their idolatry. But even here, I love that God begins this declaration to them with a beautiful picture of his grace and his mercy to them. Notice he says in verse 6, "For I, the Lord, do not change. Therefore, you, O children of Jacob, are not consumed." You see, the promises of God, they don't rest on what you or I do. They don't rest on my ability to be faithful. They don't rest on my ability to do the right thing and turn away from the wrong thing. They don't rest on who I am. They rest on God's unchanging character. They rest on the fact that he's patient with us. We talked last week about how he's a father standing at the top of the hill at the end of the road waiting for his children, waiting for you and I to come running to him. And here he's doing the exact same thing. He's calling out, "Return to me and I will return to you." Before we go any further, maybe that simple message is something that someone here today is all you need to hear. Return to the Lord. He's an unchanging, compassionate, gracious Heavenly Father who's standing at that hill waiting for you to come to him, waiting to wrap his arms around you and throw a big feast for you. Let me say it as clear as I can. Thus saith the Lord, return to me. Come to the Lord. Today, if you hear his voice, do not harden your heart. You see, even when we are far from the Lord, he's calling out to us to return to him because of his unchanging character. He sought out Adam in the garden. He sought out Abraham in the land of Ur. He sought out Moses in the desert. He sought out fishermen around the Sea of Galilee. And he is still seeking and saving the lost. Return to the Lord. Last week, we talked a lot about repentance. We talked a lot about what that means to turn from my sins. And I hope that you've spent the last week turning from specific things. I hope the Lord in his grace has brought some very specific things to your mind and your heart to turn away from. Some sinful patterns to break, some declarations to make, some stakes in the ground to put that I'm not going back there anymore. Some specific things to turn away from. And it's very important for us to turn from those things. But Scripture's very clear, and the Lord here is saying, return to me. You see, it's not enough just to turn from some things. We're called to turn towards the Lord in that. Not just to turn away, but to turn towards. I got one of those really cool, like, wood fire pizza ovens that sits out back. Have you seen these things? It's so cool. I got one of these for Father's Day, and we've been making all sorts of pizza. We have a picture of pizza just to make all of you hungry right now. But it comes out of the wood fire, and there's just a little bit char on the cheese, and the toppings just dripping off, and it's so good. Now, I know I've just showed you a picture. Take the picture down real quick. Stop thinking about pizza. No, but why are you still thinking about pizza? I just told you to turn away from pizza. Stop thinking about pizza. Now, here is a picture of an amazing burger. This is the Wolf Burger from Little Bad Wolf in Andersonville up on the north side of the city. This burger is a cure for atheism. You cannot eat this burger and think there is no God. It's four patties, melted cheese, these shoestring onions, perfectly crispy bacon with a fried egg. No one in here is thinking about pizza right now. Come on. If you're a vegan, I'm sorry. I don't know. I'm from Texas. We eat lots of meat. So, The point I'm trying to make is not to get you to all go to this place for a burger. Maybe you will after a service today. But the point of all of that is that so often we think about, like, I'm not going to do those sinful patterns. I'm not going to do those sinful patterns. The Lord brought these things to remembrance, and I know that I need to turn away, and I'm not going to do it. I'm not going to do it. I'm not. And we're thinking about it all the time. But true repentance, true returning to the Lord happens when we, like Colossians says, put off some specific things. And I hope by God's grace that he's been very specific with you this past week in some things that you need to put off, but also some things that you need to turn towards. Some activities, some practices, some mindsets that you need to put on. To be filling yourself. So you're not thinking about pizza anymore. You're thinking about that incredible burger. That you're not thinking about the patterns in this world that so easily entangle us, but you're thinking about how to honor Jesus Christ. That's when true repentance happens. And that's what God is calling for here, not just putting off these activities, but putting on these things and returning to the Lord, pursuing him with your heart and your mind and your actions and your attitudes. His patience is waiting for you to return. And that's what he's calling the people in Malachi's day to, and that's what he's calling you and I to. By his patience and his unchanging character, he is waiting and calling out, return to me. Turn from these things and turn to me to honor me. Return to me and I will return to you, says the Lord of hosts. His patience is waiting for you to return, to trust in him, and then to trust in his provision. Let's continue reading verse 10. He says, bring the full tithe into the storehouse that there may be food in my house, and thereby put me to the test. This is what I told you. Put me to the test, says the Lord of hosts, if I will not open the windows of heaven for you and pour down for you a blessing until there is no more need. He talks here, the specific instance for them of turning away from the Lord and rejecting what he had said is this idea of tithe and their tithes and their contributions. Now, a tithe specifically literally means one-tenth of your income. The people of Israel were told in Leviticus 27:30 that they were to give one-tenth of their income to the temple for the worship of God. And what happened was people were neglecting that. They get into the land, the people in Malachi's day, they get into the land and there's great poverty and there's pestilence that's happening to their crops, and they're looking at their bank account and they're like, I don't think I can spare that tenth. And so they began to skimp on that. Even though God had told them, this is what you need to do in order to worship me, the people were neglecting that. And so the temple was in desperate need of repair, in desperate need of upkeep. Now, this isn't a sermon on giving, just so you know. I think that it's broader than that, what God is telling us today through his word. But because there's so much here about their giving and about what had happened to them, I want to just take a short excursus on giving. Now, I understand people tend to bristle a little bit when churches talk about money. There's this feeling sometimes like, they just want my money. And so we kind of bristle about that, and I understand. We have a giving portion in each of our weekly gatherings because our giving is an act of worship to God. We see that in Scripture, and so it's an important part of what we do as a church family. Now, if you're newer to Harvest, if you're a guest, your presence here today, that is the only gift we want from you. It's enough. We're so glad that you are here, and we're not asking for any money from you. We're not at all. Now, there are some things as a church family Because most of us here have said, Harvest is my church. I want to be a part of the mission and the ministries that the Lord is accomplishing through our church. And so most of us, we're gathered as a church, and we believe that God wants us to accomplish some things together. That he's placed us in these communities that each of our campuses are in to be a light for Jesus Christ. And that does take some resources. And so if Harvest is your church home, we give freely to the mission and the ministries of Harvest so that that ministry can continue. It's given freely. Corinthians says God loves a cheerful giver. And so we do that so that ministry can continue. Yes, our staff does receive a wage. I realize that seems self-serving, but trust me, it's fair, but it's not anything. I drive a Toyota Corolla. You can see it out there. It's the one with the hubcap missing. So it's nothing crazy, but we do need for ministry to continue. There are buildings that we meet in and have electric bills and heating and cooling, and we need to buy goldfish for the kids' ministry, not real goldfish, but, you know, the little crackers, and crafts for them, and coffee in the lobby, and community outreach programs, and helping people in our body who are in need. There are real financial needs in our church. But can I just say, so I've been a part of our church for 4 or 5 years or so. I've been a pastor on our staff for 15 years. God has always provided. Always. I am not stressed at all. I don't stand up and talk about money and think, I really hope people... God will provide. I'm not worried or stressed about it all at all. God will continue. But I will say, as a person who has given and does continue to give to the mission and ministries of the Lord, I can't even express the joy that comes from being generous and seeing your resources used so that men and women can come to Jesus Christ. When we were very new to the church, my wife and I made a commitment and gave to some specific offerings that were happening here. And one of the things that we were investing in was a Christian camp. And it sounded so weird. My 17-year-old son is at that camp right now, worshiping his face off. We have gone there as a family. All of my kids have been there and have met Jesus in that place. I'm telling you, sitting right over here 20-something years ago, I never would have imagined that I was a broke seminary student. Who knows what we gave, but it felt at the time like so much. And to see the Lord use all of that for his purposes and see my kids now worship, such a grace that I never would have seen. The Lord uses our cheerful giving for his purposes. And so, again, this is not specifically a sermon on giving, but because it's here, I feel that we need to talk about it a little bit. There's an immense joy, and the people here in Malachi's day were being stingy about it, and like, I'm not going to do it. Even though God had specifically commanded them to give a tenth, they're like, I'm not doing it. I don't see the Lord meeting our financial needs in some ways. And some would use this passage and would say, you should give, and if you give, then God will clearly bless you financially. Because there's a lot of Christians that say that. Now, I want to be really clear. I don't believe that at all. I don't believe that God says, if you give financially to his ministries, then you're going to be wealthy. I don't think that's what's in God's word. I do believe what God says, that if we are obedient to him, then he will provide for us. That when you trust him and when you choose to obey, whether you see it or whether you don't, I believe God will take care of us. There are countless scriptures for that. I do believe what God says when he says that he will provide. If God calls you to be generous, even in times that it may not make sense on paper, to trust him and to obey is always better. And the response to that doesn't often, or most of the time I have found, doesn't look like what you and I think it will. One of the times that we were in a campaign as a church years and years ago, and my wife and I were praying about, like, Lord, would you want us to give more in some ways? And my wife specifically came with a specific number that was higher than mine, to be honest. But we spent some time praying about that, and we really believe that's what the Lord wanted us to do. And it was stressful for us because right then, we were in the middle of raising funds for an adoption. We had struggled with infertility for years, and we were like, Lord, if you've done an adoption before, you know that it's quite expensive. And we're like, Lord, how are you going to provide for this? We were told by doctors that we could not get pregnant on our own. But we believed that this was a specific number that the Lord wanted us to give at that time. We gave that number, not knowing how adoption would play out, but we believed that the Lord was leading us, was telling us to do that. And so we wanted to be faithful in those ways, specifically to what God had said. I still remember where I was standing when I got the phone call from my wife that said, I'm pregnant. And we went to the doctor and they were like, that's not supposed to happen. I mean, like, scientifically, we can't figure out, we know how it happened, but you know what I mean. God answered that prayer for us to have a child. By God's grace, we were able to adopt later on as well, but God provided all of that and more in countless ways, and that's just one little story. People in our church have story after story of how God met them in ways that they could never imagine because they were faithful. And what's happening here is the people in Malachi's time, they're looking at their bank account and they're like, we don't have it, Lord. And I know that you're calling us to do something, but I can't do that because I don't see how it's going to work. God is telling them he will provide for them. I believe God's word when he says, I will provide. So where do you need to return and to trust in God's provision? Maybe, like the people of Israel, it's in your generosity, but maybe it's in believing that God will take care of what's most dear to your heart. Jesus has this beautiful picture, this story that he tells in Luke 12. It's also in Matthew where he talks about the lilies of the field. He talks about the birds in the air, and he keeps watch over all of those. And yet you and I have that same anxiety that the disciples had. When we look at our lives and think, well, God, I want to obey you in these things. I want to obey you in my relationships. I want to obey you in my finances. I want to obey you in holiness. But God, will you actually provide? And he says, fear not, little flock. It's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. You see, Jesus echoes this same call that we see in Malachi to trust in God's provision no matter what. To obey God no matter what, and to trust in his provision as he has promised. Now, I grew up in a church when I was little. I remember we sang the old simple hymn, Trust and Obey. And those lines of that chorus are forever etched in my memory, and I am grateful for that. Trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus than to trust and obey. It's so simple to sing and yet sometimes so hard to do, to trust God's word. God, what you're calling us to do from your word, and I'm going to choose to obey and to trust in God's provision. And then finally, trust in God's power. Verse 11, we're gonna finish reading together. God says, I will rebuke the devourer for you so that it will not destroy the fruits of your soil and your vine in the field and shall not fail to bear, says the Lord of hosts. Then all the nations will call you blessed, for you will be a land of delight, says the Lord of hosts. God's power is at work when they're obedient. You see, the people were disobedient to God's command to give financially because they feared a lack of their resources. Because of the state of the land and all of the things that they saw, they saw drought and they saw insects devouring. So when it talks about the devourer, that's what it's talking about. Maybe they had their own locust problem, all of their cicadas. I don't know specifically what it was. But they feared their ability to provide. And God says, do what I say and I will take care of it. I'll provide for you. I've got you as my children. I am an unchanging, perfect provider, God, and I will provide for all of your needs. And these things, they had become an excuse for them to do the very thing that God had asked them to do. I can't give what you said, God. I can't do what you said because I might not have enough. I can't do what you've asked, God. It's too difficult for me. And maybe that exact thing isn't an issue for you. Maybe it's not at all about finances. God, I know you've said generosity is a mark of a follower of Jesus, but things are tight right now. So maybe it's about generosity, but maybe it's for obedience to God. I have found far more often that it's, again, not at all about the money. It's about obedience to the thing that God has called each of us to do. Maybe it's to the young engaged couple. You know, we know that it doesn't honor the Lord for us to be living together right now, but have you seen rent prices? We can't live apart right now. And so we're going to do this thing, even though God calls us to purity. Maybe in my family, we're just really far too busy right now to be a part of a community group, to be in part a part of any kind of biblical community where we're sharing ourselves and receiving from others and holding one another accountable and a part of a community like we see in the book of Acts. But we're just far too busy. I mean, we got soccer practice and we got trombone practice and we got all of these things, and I'm on the HOA board and I'm just too busy for all of those things to be in any kind of a community right now. Maybe it's in relationships. There's far too much hurt. There's far too much brokenness in this relationship for me to ever forgive this person. Do you know what they have done? And God says forgive them? I don't think I can do that. There's just too much. And what will happen to me, I'll be like a doormat then. Now, far too often we end up in this. I know God said blank, but I can't because what you are really saying in each one of those situations is, I don't trust you, God. Well, you might not verbalize those words, but when you say, God, I know you said this, but I, every time, the words that are coming out of your mouth may be different, but the thing that's found in your heart is, I don't believe that God is able to honor his word. I don't believe that he is trustworthy. I don't believe that he will take care of me when I choose to obey him. I don't believe that God is able to. Remember the story that's familiar to us. They're probably teaching it in kids' ministry today. The Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego in Daniel 3. They're told to bow down to a golden image of King Nebuchadnezzar, to worship that and to take part in the idolatry that all of the people around them were. And they said, our God is able to deliver us, and he will deliver us. But even if he doesn't, we will not serve these gods. No matter what happens to us, we will choose to obey God. I will obey, and I will trust. Now, I'm not going to stand up here and tell you that God's going to save you from every fiery furnace, but I think it's admirable what they say. Even if God doesn't, I will still obey him, and he will make a way another way, because God will always provide. Oh, it may not look like what I think it's going to look like. It may not feel what I think it's going to feel like. There may be days when I'm scared to death of what's going to happen, when I feel that anxiety stirring up in me. And when I do, I will choose to trust and to obey, to say God is able to deliver us. and I trust him to do so. And if you want to see miracles happen in your life, put a stake in the ground and say, God, I'm going to trust your word no matter what. If you want to see relationships healed in miraculous ways, I'm going to choose to forgive even if it doesn't make sense to me. I'm going to choose to obey and to trust God with that. If you want to see miracles in your finances and in your family and in your friendships, make up your mind ahead of time to trust the Lord no matter what and to seek to obey him. I will do what God says because he's able to handle what I'm stressed about. I will do what God says because he's going to handle what I'm stressed about. And even if he doesn't, I will still choose to obey him, to do what God calls me to do, and to trust him with the outcome. See, standing face to face with Jesus Christ in eternity, that sadly, there are things that I'm sad to say, regrets that I will have. Things that I will be ashamed of, how I thought and how I acted and how I failed to live up to what he's called me to do as his follower. But looking into the eyes of my Savior who gave everything for me, I know that I will never regret the times that I chose to obey him and to trust him, even when I couldn't see the outcome. Those will be times of joy, not of shame. Jesus tells us in John 13, 17, if you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. See, it's not enough for us just to think, yes, thus saith the Lord. He says these things to me. This whole book, he says these things to me. And it's not enough just to leave it there. It really only matters if you do them. It really only matters if it goes into your life and you put it into practice together and to trust him when he says in Luke 12, fear not, little flock, for it's your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. It's really fitting, I think, that this section ends where God is telling his people of his power to provide for them, that it closes with, says the Lord of hosts. See, this title, Lord of hosts, it happens all throughout Scripture, and it happens a ton through the book of Malachi. He's essentially saying he's the God with heavenly troops around him. He has legions of angels following him, like a conquering king coming into battle with a sea of troops riding along with him. This is why we sing the songs, the God of angel armies is on our side. It's why we sing that nothing can stand against him. The power of our God to accomplish his purposes. He is able. He has all power, and you can trust him because of that. Obey the Lord and trust him with the results, even when we may not see it. I want to hold on to the hurt at times where God is calling us to grant forgiveness to someone who doesn't deserve it. We may want to hold on to that hurt to make them somehow pay for the hurt that they have caused me. But the Lord would say, forgive as I have forgiven you. So I'm going to choose to obey and to trust him with those results. God's patience is waiting for you to come, to turn from your ways, to turn towards him. God's provision, it will take care of you because you're far greater value than birds or flowers. And God's power can handle anything that's ahead of you. You know, it's been said oftentimes that what you stress about the most is where you trust God the least. So what is it that you stress over? What's the thing that you struggle to trust the Lord with? To fully let go into his hands, to really trust him and to obey him. Maybe like the people in Malachi's day, it's financial. God, can you really provide for my needs? I just I don't see it adding up, but I'm going to trust you anyway. Maybe it's in a relationship that's broken. God, I don't see how this could ever be repaired. It is far too gone. Trust the Lord. Take the next right step. Maybe that step is to reach out in kindness. Maybe that step is to forgive the person, even if you feel like they don't deserve it. Maybe that step is to offer a cheerful gift. Maybe that step is to spend the next month praying and fasting about where the Lord would lead you. But trust and obey, for there's no other way to be happy in Jesus but to trust and obey. Let's pray. Father, we are grateful for the incredible ways that you have provided in the past. Each of us can think through countless ways that you have met us in dark times and provided immeasurably more than we could ever ask or imagine. And so, God, as we look at this passage today, as we hear your word to us, may we trust you with all that you have called us to do. Would we be obedient to what you're calling us to in your word, whether we see the outcome or not, whether we see a good response, whether it adds up on paper for us or not? God, you would call us to a greater dependence, a greater faith, a greater trust in you. And I would pray that you would stir that up in each one of us as we seek to follow you all of our days. Would we see those markers in our lives of how you have been faithful in the past and how you are continuing to be faithful in our present, and trust you for the ways that you'll be faithful in the future. May we trust you and obey at all times, in all seasons, for your glory and our good. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Let's stand together as we respond. He's the God who provides.
Make first the kingdom and its treasures, and everything else it will be added, and all that I need. And I know the Lord will provide, 'cause I know my God's not empty handed, and he gives us blessings upon blessings, and I'm still believing, and I know the Lord will provide. So seek first the kingdom, seek first the kingdom and its treasures, and everything else it will be added, all that I'm needing, and I know the I'm
Jehovah Jireh, He meets every single need. We worship You, Lord.
Woo! Good morning. Everybody awake now? Wow. It's good to be with God's people this morning. And if there's a point where you need to trust the Lord today, maybe it's I need to turn back to Him or turn to Him for the first time. Please, please, today is the day. And we're going to have people up front here who would love to talk with you and pray with you. If you've got a burden on your heart, you do not need to carry it alone. We'd love to pray for you and take that to the Lord. The special offering is an option for benevolence and compassion as you exit today. And two things. We're going to pray. This week is Wednesday night. We're going to start day of prayer and fasting Thursday night, 7 o'clock or earlier if you want something to eat. We're looking forward to praying together as a church family. And today, there's a little social in the parking lot, so don't rush out. Grab something to eat, meet somebody. I heard it's not going to be too cold, so we should be okay. So, all right. Well, hey, it's wonderful that we get to worship the Lord and we get to do it together as a church family. Now we go out on mission for Him, and do not forget, you are loved.